is you have pretty good notes in your lab notebook, but I'm going to show you the pictures, what applies to things. There are, you know, a fair amount of models that we have, and don't heavily rely on Quizlet because you have multiple models with the same structure. And Quizlet may only have one of those models. So always double check some other models because you may memorize, oh, it's this and this model, but I may use another one. I'm just warning you, okay? So, and also I forgot to put in like the histology stuff. So I will, but I'll have you guys worry about the models, and I'm gonna go look up the slides and figure out what stuff on the slides that I want you to identify. So just slides of the kidney. So, but well, I'll worry about that later because I forgot to put a little thing in there for histology. So we're gonna do, kind of start talking about, we're gonna be looking at some major structures. Obviously, we're gonna spend a lot more time on the kidney, but you should be able to, if I say now, everybody in here, if I say, go find me a ureter, I would expect everybody in here be able to identify a ureter because that's something you probably did in A&P 1 because you had to know some basic structures. So you're gonna look and be able to identify a ureter. The bladder, we do have the model, some of the bladder, and there's going to be some structures that you'll have to identify in the bladder. Some models are better than others. And then you should be able to identify the urethra, but you had to do that with the reproductive system. So what I did is I went through the cupboard because they don't want to put it out, and I put some of the models of the penis out so then you could, because again, male, you have to identify the different components of the urethra. But the kidneys is where we're going to spend the most time. Kidneys' job, it has a lot of functions. But biggest job is to filter blood to remove waste products. And so then you have that waste products, they travel down the ureters, you got two of them, store in the bladder, because you don't pee all the time, do you? I would hope not, okay? So this stores it until it gets a little full, and they're like, I gotta go, and then you get it, expel it from the body, okay? So we're gonna start right up here, but the kidneys, the urinary system, its only function is not just removal of waste products like urea, and creatinine, and uric acid. Doesn't it have a whole bunch of other functions?
Regulate blood pressure.
Does produce hormones.
Regulate blood pressure.
It's involved in blood, very important function in blood pressure regulation. It's involved in water balance, acid-base balance, yeah. Electrolyte balance. So it's a very major homeostatic, has major role in homeostasis, okay? Now, just so you have an idea where the kidneys are, so you're looking at the back of somebody, they're kind of right up here, they kind of hang a little bit below your rib cage. You do have partial protection from your rib cage. Everybody's like grabbing here. But the thing is, sometimes if you've got kidney infections, people start having pain in their back, okay? Mm-hmm. So, but you do have some partial protection from your ribs, and we do have the one of the kidneys kind of falls a little bit lower than the other because the liver gets in the way. Remember that liver's huge? Mm-hmm. So, like again, you can gut one of these guys. Let's see if they have it anatomically correct. Sometimes.
I would hope so.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, it's lower.
It's a little bit lower. So the right side just slightly a little bit lower. Because you remember the liver, like this, kind of liver gets in the way, okay? So here's our kidneys. Oh, I should be able, ooh. Now those are too small, I'm not gonna have you identify stuff on that. But those are the kidneys, okay? So I'll just keep that gutted. All right, so we have, the one thing about the kidneys, and I say this term, see if you remember, figure out what I'm saying. The kidneys are retroperitoneal. The adrenals are retroperitoneal. What does that mean? Yeah, it's behind the peritoneum, or peritoneum, depending, tomato, tomato, how you pronounce it. So it's behind it, okay? So it, let's see what else, cool information. Oh, it's kind of held in place. A lot of times it's held in place. You got some fascia that kind of holds it in place, but you also have some adipose tissue, which it doesn't really show you here, but you have some adipose tissue that kind of helps to hold it in place. So one of the things you have to worry about are people that lose weight too quickly is the kidneys can fall out of place. And if it falls out of place, it kinks up the ureters and it can cause backup. So the urinal backup and cause what we call hydronephrosis, which could damage the kidneys. So they call it the term, that some of you may have heard of it before, renal ptosis, You may remember hearing about that?
Yes.
If you took me in AP1, you might have heard, because when I looked, taught you guys about adposition, this was one thing I talked about, where you find adposition. I use this as an example. So you do have some fat that kind of holds it in place, okay? All right, let's see what else we got. All right, so here's showing you retroperitoneal. Okay. All right, so let's look at the kidney. Now this one's ugly. So I'm not looking at the real life kidney because it's all ugly. So I'm going to look at the model, okay? And that's what you're going to use as models. So I have to go through, and you have all the parts written out for you, but we're going to use this so you can kind of see what's the significance of it. Because you kind of have to know where, you know, what the structure is to understand, like, okay, this is an event that takes place here. So the kidneys have a cortex, an outer cortex, and a medulla. Isn't there a lot of organs that have a cortex and a medulla? Okay. Cortex is out here, and when we zoom in, we're going to show you this is where the glomeruli are. This is where filtration will take place. There's a lot of blood flow that goes out to the renal cortex. So glomerular filtration is going to take place out of there. And we're going to see a lot of parts of the nephron tubule are going to be located in that cortex. The medulla, big thing you see in the medulla are these renal pyramids. They kind of look like pyramids. Well, you'll see the striped appearance to it is due to these loops of Henle and also the thing called a medullary duct that goes in the direction towards here, because we're going to be forming urine out here and eventually it's going to be going in this direction and in here and then out that way, okay? So we have these pyramids, and at the tips of the pyramids we have what we call renal papilla. We have things called papillary ducts. So when we look at the structure of a nephron tubule, we're going to see all these things empty into like medullary ducts and eventually papillary duct, because the urine is going to be formed out here, travel in this direction, empty into these structures here called the minor calyx, or plural is calyces. So the urine's going to empty into a minor calyx and then go into a little bigger one called a major calyx. So you got a few in here, and then it empties into the renal pelvis, then to the ureter, okay? Starting from the renal pelvis, ureter, tell me what type of epithelium that you would find lining the renal pelvis in the ureter.
Transitional
epithelium. Why do we need transitional epithelium? What is so unique about the transitional?
It can change,
the cells can change their shape, because what's gonna happen, you're gonna have urine, it's gonna stretch it out. And so remember that if it's that transitional epithelium is not stretched, you have those dome cells, and as it stretch, it flattens out. And what also describe transitional, is it one layer, multiple layers? Multiple layers. Again, why do we want multiple layers?
So it doesn't break.
Well, not necessarily do we want to break.
Is it so it can go back to its shape?
Nope, not in that word. That has nothing to do with the multiple layers. I mean, it does go back, change its shape, but the multiple layers is you've got waste products and all that urine. You don't want it seeping through into the underlying tissue. Isn't the bladder lined by transitional too?
Yeah.
So it's because it's you're holding all these waste products, so you don't have to have multiple layers. But being transitional allows it to change shape, and it does like to go back to its original position. So that's why we have the transitional there. All right, so let's see. The kidneys do have a capsule called the renal capsule. So the renal capsule is a little fibrous connective tissue. Kind of provides some sort of protection, okay? We have the renal capsule. Also, I do have to mention this thing called the renal lobe. This is a renal lobe. This is a renal lobe. This is a renal lobe. It's that pyramid and the overlying cortex is a renal lobe. The reason why I'm going to mention that is I'm going to mention an interlobar artery, and guess where the interlobar arteries run? Between the lobes. That's why they call it the interlobar artery. So this here is referred to as a renal lobe. Okay, let's see. There's something else in there that oh, do you remember hilus? The term hilus? So just like that, some of the other organs, it's kind of the indentation area where things are coming in and coming out. So in the kidneys, we got blood vessels coming in and coming out. We've got ureters. You've got nerves. So again, it's just a general area. It's kind of where that indented area is, okay? So, and how many kidneys do we have?
Two.
Two, or most of us, right? Some of us only may have one, but we should have two, okay? All right, here, this one's gonna show you the blood supply. The thing about the kidneys is the blood supply is arranged in a series circuit. So you go from one vessel to the next, to the next, to the next. It's not run in parallel. And so when you have this, it goes back to physics, and now some people are like, oh. When you have things set up in series, it provides a high resistance. So you're summing all the resistance as you're going along. And the thing is, I want high resistance here because I want high pressure. You want a very high blood pressure in those glomeruli because that's gonna allow for really good filtration. So we have a special arrangement of the blood vessels, plus I'm gonna show you how two of the vessels are designed, and we're gonna use that to our advantage. So we start with the renal arteries. Anybody in here should be able to identify a renal artery because we made you do that for your last quiz and practical. So you have the renal arteries. Now they're gonna branch. Okay, so when you branch them, they branch off into segments, so we call them segmental arteries. So you have maybe 3, 4, 5 maybe per kidney. And then after they segment, we're gonna have those interlobar arteries because they're running between the renal lobes. So you see a bunch of them here. And as they come up, they're then going to arc. And where they're arcing is kind of that, it's like dividing that cortex from the dull. It's kind of like that point. So they kind of arc around those renal tops of those renal pyramids. So they call it an arcuate artery. So does that make sense? Well, it looks like kind of arcs. So I'm trying to make it so it's easier for you to remember the names of these vessels. So you have arcuate arteries, and then you're gonna have these interlobular. That's where people confuse them. Interlobar and interlobular are different. So like think little lobules. So, but we have these interlobular arteries, which you'll now see are found in the cortex. Up until then, we were pretty much in the medulla. So we have these interlobular. Now I gotta zoom in, and that's not even zoomed in as much as I want. Here's some interlobular arteries. So you see these little things coming off here? Each one of these is supposed to be glomerulus, but you can't see really well what I want you to see. So I'm gonna show you, I'm gonna zoom in one more so you can see what's gonna happen. Well, that doesn't do it. Does it? What a better picture. Oh, here, this is what I want to show you. Okay, so, there we go. Okay, so interlobular arteries are then gonna become afferent arterioles. Afferent, what does afferent mean to you?
Going in
or going towards, okay?
Yeah.
This is your feeder vessel. This is gonna be bringing blood to the glomerulus, which is our filtration unit. And the thing is, after the glomerulus, we have an efferent arteriole. Really what this is you've taken one vessel and then you just stuck a feeder vessel right in between it. So it's really one continuous structure. And so the blood is coming in through the afferent arteriole. The glomerulus, and you can remind me what type of capillary the glomerulus is, because it is a capillary.
Fenestrated.
So remember, it has some windows. It's a little more porous than a continuous, but not quite as porous as a sinusoidal. So having the fenestrated capillaries is going to allow us to get a lot more things out of the blood, except proteins, large proteins, and blood cells. But water, sodium, glucose, all this other stuff is gonna be filtered out. And it's very nonspecific. It's gonna filter all the good stuff along with the bad stuff, except for blood cells and plasma. Whatever's left behind is gonna leave through the efferent arteriole, so it's gonna go away. Now, there is a difference in the diameter of these two arterioles. This is a little bit fatter than this. It's designed on purpose that way. Because if you have, you're bringing in blood here, and I got my little filtration unit, and I got over here a little bit thinner vessel, it provides a little bit more resistance, provides a little back pressure, so you can have a lot more higher pressure in the glomerulus, so we can get the filtration that we want. And we actually utilize that to our advantage if I want to regulate filtration. Is if I need to get pressure to go up a little bit more, I can constrict this, not too much, but I can constrict it, or I could open this up because I'm going to bring more blood in here. So that's how we're going to physiologically regulate glomerular filtration, is changing those diameters of those arterioles. Okay, so it's set up a certain way. Now, once you have the efferent arteriole, I'm going to draw a picture for this one. So the efferent arteriole, here's my glomerulus. Here's my efferent arteriole, and I'm going to draw real quick. It's not nowhere near accurate. Here's my nephron tubule. So I'm going to filter stuff here. And as I go along the nephron tubule, what am I going to want to do? I filtered glucose and amino acids and sodium and potassium and lactic acid and creatinine. I filtered a whole bunch of stuff. I just maybe just digested food. And I got all my fructose and glucose and amino acids. Do I want that to go out my urine?
No, you want to drain it filter it into your bloodstream.
I want to get it back into my bloodstream. So it's been removed. Mm-hmm. I want to recapture it. So as we go down this nephron tubule, we have mechanisms to reabsorb the good stuff back. If there's something that, if it wasn't filtered, that maybe I need to get rid of, there's a mechanism called secretion where I can, from the blood, put things back into the nephron tubule. Now the nephron tubule is surrounded by a capillary network and actually comes from this efferent arteriole. So here's the efferent arteriole. It's going to come around and we're going to actually form like little blood vessels that kind of circle the nephron tubule. So if I reabsorb something, eventually it's going to go back into the bloodstream. So technically the kidneys have two capillary networks. Has glomeruli, which is really not a true capillary. You know why I say it's not really a true capillary? Because the only thing that should happen there is filtration. There's no reabsorption at all. So it's just like you just have filtration, that's it, no reabsorption. Here, with the paratubular capillaries, we can have things go back in the blood, or we can have things go from the blood into the nephron tubule. So that is more of a true capillary type network. So we have these paratubular capillaries. Can you break down the word? Peri?
Around.
Like perimeter? Mm-hmm. It's kind of around the tubules. So we have paratubular capillaries. Now if I go back, we do have, if we have arteries and arterioles and all that, shouldn't we have veins? So we do. I don't really care about naming the veins, but we do. There's like one of them that doesn't have a name, so here. So, this thing's being really weird.
Would you say that the paratubular capillaries extend from? Is it the
efferent? Efferent. Okay, they're coming from the efferent arteriole. So here, you see in schematic, efferent arteriole becomes the paratubular capillaries, okay? And eventually, you drain into venules. Then you've got your interlobular veins, arcuate veins, interlobar veins. The only thing we don't have is segmental veins. So you have the veins that are taking all the deoxygenated blood and all the other stuff away. Okay, so we have this extensive vascular network in the kidneys. A lot of it pretty much you need that filtration so you can get rid of the waste products. But we will recapture the good stuff. Or couldn't we, like if we got a little bit too much calcium in our body or too much potassium, could we maybe get rid of it in the urine? So we can do that. So if we have a little excess of stuff, this is one way we can get rid of it. So but we're going to make sure we get rid of the waste products. Anything that we want to get back, we're going to get back. We can fine tune things if we need to. Okay, all right, so we'll talk about the filtration, right, how we regulate it. So here's some of the functions of the nephron. You're seeing here two different types of nephrons. So we have cortical nephron, juxtamedullary nephron. Look at the picture. Why do they call the one the cortical nephron?
Because it's probably in the cortex.
You see, most of it's in the renal cortex. Most of your nephrons in the kidney are cortical. You'll see just a little bit of this little structure here called the loop of Henle that dips down to the medulla. Juxtamedullary, look at a lot of this part here. They have these things. This is a loop of Henle. It's very long loops of Henle. And juxta means kind of next to the medulla. You'll see a lot of this part here, very long loops of Henle go in the medulla. These ones, these nephrons are very important in water balance. The way they're designed is that you can reabsorb a lot more water. So they're going to be very important in water balance. But they'll do similar things as the cortical in regards to filtration, getting rid of waste products. But these guys are very important in water balance, okay? So nephrons, we're going to see the filtration that takes place, reabsorb anything like the organic nutrients will be like your glucose, your fructose, your amino acids. Reabsorb those. Reabsorb any water and ions, any excess we can get rid of, and secrete any things that may be like certain drugs are secreted. When I say secreted to you, I'm going to like distinguish between filtration, reabsorption, and secretion. We're talking about glomeruli, okay? Glomerular filtration, going from glomerulus into this structure here called Bowman's capsule. So this is glomerular filtration. Reabsorption, tubular reabsorption. We're going from inside the tubule back into the bloodstream. Okay, so we're going to reabsorb it. We're not absorbing it. We're reabsorbing it because at some point it was reabsorbed already. We're just reabsorbing it. So reabsorption is this direction. What's secretion?
Putting into the blood.
For, say again?
Putting something into the blood.
No. Not in this case. If I'm going to do tubular secretion, it's going to go from the blood to the tubule. So I'm going to secrete it in here. If it stays in here, eventually it's going to go into the toilet. Okay? So tubular secretion is we're going to go from the blood into the tubule. It's a way of getting rid of excess stuff in some instances. We secrete things like hydrogen ions. You secrete potassium, and some drugs are secreted along the nephron tubule. So we'll talk, we're gonna look, show you kind of the basic structure of the nephron tubule too. So you can see, you just see real basic here. Now you notice here, since it's already here, papillary ducts, because we're down here, we're close to that renal papilla, okay? So these are papillary ducts right here, okay? Technically says collecting duct, but it's actually referred to as a medullary duct because we're in the medulla. Okay, so if we have a collecting duct, it's collecting fluid from different nephrons. If you find it in the cortex, guess what we call it? Cortical collecting duct. If you see it in the medulla, we refer to it as a medullary duct. Okay, so we're just collecting it from different nephrons. All right, so let's look here. This is showing you the nephron, and these are the paratubular capillaries. Now notice here, they gave it a different name. Those juxtamedullary nephrons, those capillaries that around that loop of Henle, they refer to as the vasa recta, okay? So that's the term we use for it. When we talk about water balance, these guys will be important, we'll talk about it. So they're not called paratubular capillaries, they're called vasa recta, okay? So just keep that in mind when we talk about that at a later date. So here, let's go through the different parts of the nephron tubule so you're aware of what's what. And I'll give you very quickly basic things that take place in each part of that nephron tubule. These are your functional units of the kidney. You got millions of these in your kidneys, okay? So the red is supposed to represent what? This all is here.
Glomerulus.
This is the glomerulus. Okay, notice, what do you think that is? The red coming in before it becomes the glomerulus. What's that supposed to be? Afferent arteriole. And then as it leaves, we're gonna call it the efferent arteriole. When you look at the models, you should be able to tell the difference between the afferent and efferent, even though they're not gonna give you arrows, is look for the diameter, okay? Also see where it's going. Efferent arteriole will become paratubular capillaries. So when you're looking at some of the models, you keep that in mind when you're trying to figure out which is which, okay? So here, the glomerulus and this structure here, I was like, here's the glomerulus. You have this structure here. This is Bowman's capsule. Okay, so this is Bowman's capsule. Collectively, this is called the renal corpuscle. This is where glomerular filtration takes place. You're going from the blood into this Bowman's capsule. There's a little space here, but eventually it's going to go into the Bowman's capsule. And in lecture, we'll talk about what determines net filtration. It all comes down to those Starling's forces. Remember hydrostatic pressures and osmotic pressures that you're like, oh, we're going to talk about that again. But we're going to have a very high filtration pressure. So we got renal corpuscle. Then what we're going to do, this first part is the proximal convoluted tubule. So why do you think they call it convoluted? It's all convoluted. Okay, it's cool. It's all convoluted. But we do actually have a proximal tubule, which is actually not all convoluted. It's more straight. I'm okay if you say proximal tubule or proximal convoluted tubule, even where, no matter where I am, as long as you say one or the other, I don't care. But I want you to think proximal tubule, because we're going to talk about a distal tubule. So the proximal tubule is closer to the Bowman's capsule. Okay? So here's the proximal tubule. This has a more of a, it's simple epithelium. It's got one layer, and it tends to be cuboidal shaped. So the reason why it's not squamous is we have to have room for different, be able to make different transport proteins, because transport proteins are going to allow us to get the stuff back out. Okay, there's a lot of microvilli found in the proximal tubule. And what are microvilli used for?
Absorption.
Increases surface area for absorption. So you have the proximal tubule is well adapted for absorption, because a lot of absorption is going to take place. In this case, reabsorption is going to take place in the proximal tubule. You're going to reabsorb all your organic nutrients here. All the glucose that was filtered will be reabsorbed here. All your amino acids, all your fructose, all of that, the organic nutrients will be reabsorbed. If it makes its way past it, we have no means, no transport proteins to reabsorb them, so it'll appear in your urine, okay? But they should, under normal conditions, all be reabsorbed here. But we'll reabsorb things like potassium, and sodium, and lactate, and I can go on and on and on. There's a lot of things that are reabsorbed here. We'll secrete some hydrogen ions. That'll be important in bicarbonate reabsorption and acid-base balance. So you have some secretion here. Like I said, some hydrogen ions that are going to be secreted here are some drugs. So there's a lot going on in the proximal tubule. Then you have this structure here. This is called the loop of Henle, because it's a loop. But we have to break it down. We're going down. Descending loop. Okay, because we're going down. In what direction am I going down? Towards the medulla. Okay, so this is the descending limb. Look at, how is it thickness compared to here? It's thinner. Okay, the reason why it's so thin is not a lot of going on in there. It's just water reabsorption. That's it. That's it. Only water's being reabsorbed there. That's it. Okay, so we don't need a lot of transport proteins. Then we come up here. We have to break it up into two different components. This is the thin ascending limb. A lot of boring stuff going on here. I'm not going to mention it because it's so boring. Sounds like there's stuff going on there, but not much. So this is the thin ascending limb. This is the thick ascending limb. You've got reabsorption that takes place of like sodium and potassium and chloride and calcium. So we'll talk about very specifically some things that take place there, and there's a very important transporter there that we'll talk about later. But one cool thing about this structure is this structure will reabsorb ions, but it's impermeable to water. Remember, water always wants to follow? Remember, water will always follow the solutes because it wants to maintain osmotic equilibrium, but only if that membrane is permeable to it. Water doesn't follow it. Okay, so you have all these ions that are being reabsorbed, but water stays in. So what's going to happen to the concentration of the fluid in here?
It's
going to
be less concentrated.
Less concentrated. It's going to be dilute. That's actually important, believe it or not. So it's going to be dilute as you're coming up here. As you come down here, when it loses water, but